Those of you who are visitors, welcome to Northside Christian Center. Love to have you here this evening. We're going to start off with a little prayer. Can I have everybody stand, please, and just begin to get your hearts focused on the Holy Spirit that dwells inside us, and focus on the Heavenly Father that out of His love gave us Jesus. Send back the Holy Spirit to dwell in us that we may be and thrive and do all that He have us to do, to be that mighty witness for His Son Jesus. So just focus on that which is of God. Lift your hands. And begin to let that heavenly language come out of your mouth. But we just thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for being God and God all by yourself. We just thank you for your Son Jesus and your Holy Spirit that you sent to us, Father God. We lift up our hands in submission to you and all that you would have us to do. We lift up our hands that we may submit to the will of the Holy Spirit to worship you. For we can't worship you without him, Father God. But we worship you in spirit and in truth. So we just thank you right now, Father God. We give you all the glory for all the good things that you have bestowed upon us this day. We give you all the glory for bringing us through all the not so good things that might have happened to us this day. We just give you the glory for being there with us, because you promised never to leave us or to forsake us. So we just thank you, Lord. Oh, merciful, wonderful God, we just thank you, for we could not be without you. We could not exist without you. For you're the song in our heart. You're the pep in our step. You're the breath in our lungs. You're the food on our table, because the word says that we cannot live by bread alone, but every word. Every word, Lord, that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So we just thank you. Thank you, Lord. Come on, lift your voices. You are mighty God. We just love you, Lord. Lord, we lift our voice to you. Give you all the glory. We give you the shout of praise. Oh, my Lord. Send him in the quail. We thank you, Father God, for the ministry that you have brought to share with us today, Father. We just thank you for the anointing that's on this ministry, Father God. We thank you for our pastor and his wife. We thank you for the family that gave us the opportunity to share in that time of his father and his mother, and made them fathers, spiritual fathers and spiritual mothers to us, Father God. So we just thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just feel that we need to just, sometimes we do lift our hands, we praise Lord, we praise God, but somebody needs to hear from the Lord right now. So with the music playing softly, just kind of just get in a listening mood. Get in a listening mood. Raise your hands. You don't have to say a word. Just focus on him. Listen. as an individual. Oh, he loves our praise. But I feel in my heart the Lord is telling me that sometimes we don't listen. So with the music playing softly, just listen.
Thank you. He's my light. And it comes out of the scripture in Psalms 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? The psalm says, I have no reason to fear. It also reminds me of Psalms 91 that says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I say, the Lord, he is my refuge. He's your refuge. I don't have no reason to fear. I don't have to be afraid of anything. I don't have to be afraid of the owl by day, nor the fire by night. Reason to fear. You may want to spread out, kind of move a little bit. It's a fun song.
Bye. You think they drunk? They not drunk as you think they are. They not drunk, as, but they are drunk. Drunk on the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Glory to God. Woo. Woo.
Materially and mentally. Father, may the Holy Spirit have total freedom tonight. And we give you all the glory and honor and praise in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't y'all stand up right there by you, just shake hands with one or two people. Tell them you love them, you're glad they're here. There's somebody right there that just love on somebody.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Go ahead and open your Bibles to Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I'm teaching today on the God who cares for you. And tonight, tomorrow night, I'm going to be men, lest the Holy Spirit tell me something else. But the God who cares for you. Hallelujah. Sister Karen, how you doing? Boy, I love you. Here in Galatians chapter 2, always bring your Bible to church. And, you know, I do look up on my iPad certain, you know, scriptures, different translations. So I had to have all, I used to have all these Bibles on my desk. Now, you know, I just had that. But I read out my Bible every day, man. I don't want to read on my iPhone. I can't turn the pages on that thing. And I'm not against anybody, do I? I told you, I need my Bible. My Bible's anointed. Amen. Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I. So you gonna live, yet not you. You gonna live as the new man, your spirit man, and then you ain't gonna live as your old man. So I'm crucified with Christ. So you should daily have an identity that you died with Christ. Your old man died with Christ on the cross. You should have that identity. So you don't keep living in who you used to be.
Amen.
And so you identify, I've been crucified with Christ. I've been crucified. So say that to yourself. I've been crucified with Christ.
I've been crucified with Christ.
Well, you have to identify that Jesus died for our sin, but you identified you was up there, your old man was up there with him. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Now get this now. This is important. But Christ liveth in me. Now that's me.
Amen.
You have noticed it didn't say you live in you. It said Christ liveth in me. And listen, saint, you understand that Jesus is perfect. Do you understand he never sinned once? So if he gonna live in you, that means perfect gonna live in you every day. It has to. He can't teach you to have faults, and he can't teach you to struggle and have shortcomings. He doesn't bring you tests and trials and troubles that the world bring you. He do bring tests and trials to all Christians, and that's to obey what he said. And he might tell you go love somebody and they get mad at you. But it wasn't him that brought the madness to you. It was him that said, go and tell them about my love. So when Christ liveth in you, saints, somebody ain't going to get to live no more. Everybody can't live. Christ liveth in me. He got to be telling you what to do. That's the only way he can live in somebody, tell you what to do every day. If he ain't telling you what to do every day, he ain't living in you. You might be born of his spirit, but he ain't living in there if he ain't telling you what to do. Christ liveth in me. And here it is, when he lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh. How many of y'all know you can't get rid of that thing? No, we don't have to live by the flesh, but we can't get rid of them. Man came with me tonight. Where yours at? You got to wash that baby, that thing here today. You can't get rid of that thing. You cannot walk in it, but you can't get rid of it. And so the life which I now live in the flesh. Now listen carefully now. I live by the faith of the Son of God. Oh, I'm living by his faith. I'm living by the faith of the Son of God. Now this guy, his faith was how the Father loved him, he loved me. When I put faith in his faith, how he loved me, I love you. So the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So the life I'm living now is by what he did for me, not what I can do for him. Because he's supposed to produce the life that I live today. And when you have struggles, you're producing that life, not him. And here's a major issue that Christians really need to get a turn to. First Peter chapter 5, verse 6. The God who cares for us. You got to know a little something about this. If you, the faith of the Son of God, not how you love him. And we should love him after he first loved us. But the faith of the Son of God is how he loved me and gave himself. I mean, well, how did he love me? I didn't say where. Where is the cross? How did Jesus love me? He took my sins away.
Yes.
He's not going to do it. He's not going back to the cross. It's up to you to hear that and believe and speak that and act upon that. And believe Jesus told me in 1988, I'd see him after 3 months. Told him I'd had one tag when I had two when I was in the world. That lady was so mean to the person in front of me. Jesus told me later, if you just told the truth, I would have made her give you one. But because of fear, I said two. And for the first time, in 3 months of walking in the glory, I felt like my heart fell down to the floor. And the devil said, oh, that's it. That's it. God's through. I cried on the 13th floor of the Andrew Jackson State Building, downtown Nashville. I cried all the way with 15 people on that elevator. And I told the Lord over and over, I was sorry. I never read 1 John. I never read the Bible once till I got saved. Now you know I grew up in church with my grandma, and we went to the Missionary Baptist. Now listen, and I go to the BTU with her, Sunday school. You're going to learn the Lord's Prayer and Psalm 23 if you go to a Baptist church. I can quote them when I was drunk. They just said to me every service, the Lord, and I said out loud, the Lord, my shepherd. We even preached it a little bit, man. We wouldn't even say it. And so I learned things going to church. What was I telling y'all right for that? I got to think about going back to the Baptist church. I got so beat up by the devil, I hadn't got to 1 John 1:9. I didn't know about forgiveness. And I had never had that experience. And so for 3 days, I kept repenting. Every time the thought would come to me, I'd cry and repent. And tell the Lord over and over how sorry I was. Then I'd go preach or pray with people, knowing it would come home and leave. And then as soon as I got quiet, it came back, just beat on me. And after 3 days, the Lord got tired of me doing that. And he opened my Bible. He used to do a lot when the first 5-10 years I was saved. He'd open my Bible up, the 1 John. Chapter 1 took all the words off the page, said verse 9. The rest of the page was white. And 1 John 1:9 was bigger, like he put a giant print on it. He said, read this. I said, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now see, when you read that, you did read that. But Jesus spoke to me after I read that. That's where revelation gonna come in. And here's what Jesus said to me. The first time you asked me, I forgave and forgot it. And see, I don't know what you just heard.
Yes, sir.
But I heard, and I said this when he said it. He said, the first time you asked me, I forgave and forgot. I said, what? What? Who was that? For the first time, he said, that's your enemy. I didn't even know the devil was an enemy like that. I know I cast thoughts down every day. And so, I never have lived in condemnation my whole Christian walk. This ain't done. I don't let nothing come and beat me up about nothing, because it's not Jesus. Anything that whoop on me, I know it ain't him. I don't care if I messed up, it ain't supposed to whoop on me. Hello, he convicts you. He don't beat the daylights out of you. And so when Christians don't know this, see, then they wrestle.
Yeah.
And it's a hard walk when you don't understand. When you ask one time, he forgives and forgets it. Now let me share with you what that means. Well, most Christians don't know this. You get the thoughts, it's not sin. It's when you want to do them. But I learned this from the Lord. To watch every thought that comes to my mind. I've been doing it for 28 and a half years. I watch everything come to see if it's Jesus or not. And praise the Lord. I forgive you. Where was I at now? And so when I ask the Lord to forgive me for saying something, didn't think that right. Didn't do something he said right away. I believe. And listen, I believe with all my heart. I said, Lord, I'm sorry for saying I shouldn't say that about that person. I said, Lord, you forgive me and wash me in your blood and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Now, what I believe? Well, what would you believe now? Well, most people don't know. Well, what would you believe? Think about it. Well, what do you believe? Well, no, don't believe now. He gonna forgive you and all that. Listen, I believe I'm forgiven. He remembers it no more. That's just as simple as I know to be. I really believe he don't remember it no more. Therefore, any voice bringing that back up, I know ain't him.
Amen.
I done lived like this 28 and a half years. He cannot beat you up when you had his revelation.
Amen.
Because you know it ain't Jesus.
Amen.
He is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you.
Hallelujah.
From all unrighteousness. He's already done did it on the cross.
Hallelujah.
He don't even have no choice. He don't even get to decide. He don't even get to decide about your healing.
Amen.
You know, unless you're in unforgiveness or something, but it still ain't him deciding. Your unforgiveness hindering it. It still ain't him. He still provided it. And so I learned. Man, that was such a marvelous revelation. It kept condemnation out. And so, verse 6, 1 Peter 5, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of love. Now, God is love. Everybody say, God is love.
God is love.
Love is not God. They ain't even in the Bible. People say that, it's done put intellect in this. But God is love. Love is Jesus on the cross.
Yes, yes.
You can't see God. The Bible said Jesus brought God out where God can be seen. He interpreted God Jesus revealed God. Jesus came to make God known, John 1:18. Colossians 1:15 said, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. Jesus said, at his own lips, y'all, I just quoted, no man know the Father but the Son. Matthew 11:27, neither know any man the Son except the Father. And Jesus said, whomsoever I will, I reveal you. So you can read the Old Testament, but you don't know God accurately. Because nobody back there knew God accurately. They knew about God. Abraham never believed God. But Jesus said, Abraham never told y'all the truth because he didn't know the truth. Jesus said he was the truth. I said, Moses was used by God mightily, but he didn't know love. He wouldn't have got mad and hit that rock. And Moses feared, and every man feared, and Jesus never feared. He knew God. When Jesus appeared to me in 1998, he told me during his 6-week vision, he said to me, there's only two places in the Bible that God can be seen. See, somehow accurately. Where you could just look directly at that. He said, in the beginning, when he created the earth, everything was perfect and very good. He didn't create no evil. He didn't create nothing bad. He didn't create sin. He didn't create death. It was all good. Adam was supposed to live forever. Never die. And then Jesus said, when you see me where there's no sin, he said everywhere else in the Bible it's going to look cloudy until I give you the perfect picture of God. That's what Jesus told me. Then he quoted to me from his own lips, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to God but by me. And Jesus said this to me. Can you quote that? I quoted it. He said, many of my people believe, I'm quoting word for word, many of my people believe I'm the only way to get to God. He said, many, because the Jews don't, they were his people. I said, Lord, I'm thinking that's what I believe. And then Jesus said these astounding words. Not only am I the only way to get to God, I'm the only way to accurately know God. And this is revelation to me. Then he quoted, because when Jesus appeared to me, I made him quote me verses every time he said something to me. He said, if you know me, John 14, verse 7, if you know me, you'll know my Father also. He never said, go know God. Go read, you know God. Go read, you understand what they say. Jesus had to show you what that means. He had to open the scriptures up to disciples, open their understanding. They could not read it and understand it clearly.
Amen.
You understand what it does? You don't say praying in Ephesian prayers, we can already have it. And so Jesus said, if you know me, you'll know my Father also. From henceforth, you know him and seen him because you know Jesus and seen him. These are so many scriptures where Jesus confirms this in the gospel, child, that he's the only one who knew God accurately. Jesus said, blessed are your eyes which see the things which you see. I tell you, many kings and prophets desire to see what you see and never saw, and to hear what you hear and never heard them. Luke 10:23-24. He was the bread of life. He was the word made flesh. He had the spirit without measure. Whatever that means. You know, I mean, a lot of this stuff you have to believe. And y'all ever figured that out? The spirit without measure. I mean, you know, wasn't no more to get. But watch now. He's everything. Everything was created by Jesus. All things were made by him. He is the Alpha and Omega. I'm not taking nothing away from the Father. The Father, the one sent him. The Father, my heavenly Father, which art in heaven, wants me to exalt his word over him. He wants me to exalt what he say through Jesus over him. He wants his word to mean more to me than me saying his name. People get all off of these names, all about baptisms. I'm baptizing by the authority of the Lord Jesus in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I mean, Jesus said, baptize in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Where you going? Now you can't knock Jesus out. The apostles baptized by the authority of Jesus. Well, I didn't do both of them. People just, man, the Bible is not supposed to make you have strife. So when you humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, the Bible says submit to God. But you're really submitting to Christ. You can't submit to God. You don't see God. Jesus spoke what God said and did what he saw the Father do. You should never have a picture of God that you didn't get from Jesus or ain't in line with Jesus. Because Jesus said he the way, the truth, and the life. He the only man ever lived on this earth who said, when you see me, you see my Father. That's deep. Ain't no religion got nobody like that, because they would have been blasphemed. They would have cut his head off saying something like that. And they tried to kill Jesus, but couldn't. Could nobody take his life? He had to lay it down. He had power to lay it down and power to take it again. And he's the Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. I just want to talk about him tonight to y'all. He is the Messiah. He is the great I am. Now let me go to John 4. Hold on there, 1 Peter, don't let that slip. St. John chapter 4, verse 24. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. This woman said to Jesus, that was at the well. Listen to her words. Any of y'all got a New Living Translation? A New Living's Translation? You do? Okay, I'm going to read this. This woman told Jesus in verse 25, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. And listen at the revelation that woman had. We had a revelation. No Gentile had a revelation. When he is come, he will what? Tell us all things about God. God told me there were two things. This is what Jesus told me in that vision in 98. He said that there were two things that God kept secret. He showed me all the scriptures. I got all the scriptures for him. I can't preach at night, but I got it. He said there were two things God hid from man. Only Christ reveals it. How to love just like God. Adam had it, but didn't know how to walk in it. And how to rule the devil. Adam had the authority, but didn't know how to use it. Adam was the first man, earthly. Jesus was the second man, the Lord from heaven. He was a man who God was in, speaking through, and representing what the Father is and the Father do. And those two things, no man, no prophet, no king, nobody walked in ruling the devil. They didn't have no name that was about. God had to come down and whoop the devil for them. He had to come down and defeat him because he had the authority. That's why he told Israel to bring them tithes and offerings in my house, that they may be meat in my house, and prove me herewith that I will open the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing, there ain't enough room to receive. Well, he ain't doing that no more. When he sent Jesus, he sent you everything. God ain't sending nothing else out of heaven no more. You got Christ in you. What are you trying to get from God? He provides for you according to his riches and glory in Christ. He is the mystery of God. Christ in us, the hope of glory. He is the everything we'll ever need. Well, why are you trying to get something else out of heaven? Listen. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. He ain't rebuking the devil no more. We got to rebuke him. He has gave us. us the keys to the kingdom, that what we bind on earth is bound in heaven. What we loose on earth is loosed in heaven. Jesus said, I give you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. He said, in my name, you will cast out devils. I give you authority. I command you to take my name and make the devil let your stuff go. Oh, yes. Jesus said, Peter, up on this rock, I'm going to be on my church. On the revelation, listen to that, I'll be preaching wrong. On the revelation, not the revelation of Jesus. That's 50%. But the revelation of who Christ, Peter said, you're the Christ, the Son of God. You're the one who came from God. And when we hear and speak and do what you say, now the storms are going to hit you in your words, and they're not going to hit us, and they're not going to prevail against his church, because we have revelation how to do what he says. He said the gates of hell will not prevail. He ain't trying to whoop them no more. He's trying to get us to live in Christ where the devil can't rule. He said, give thanks unto the Father, Colossians 1:20, who have made you meek, able to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who have delivered you from the power of darkness. The Amplified said, out of the control of the devil, he took you out of one kingdom and put you in the kingdom of the Son of his love. The victory is ours. He's already won it for us. Quit trying to win. You have already won. If you believe and do what Jesus tells you to do. That victory ain't yours till you do what he tell you to do. You talk about all you want, ain't gonna do you no good.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Y'all in John 4, verse 25. This woman said, oh, I know the Messiah coming. Listen. What was she blind to? Who was there? Oh, I know the Messiah's coming. It's called Christ. When he's come, the new leader said, he's going to explain everything to us about God. Now, what did the Jews knew God's power? The Jews knew God's commandments. The Jews seen the laws. They knew about their sins being covered every year. They knew all kinds of stuff about God. But two things they didn't know. They would kill you for committing adultery, stone you to death. They didn't know by love. And they didn't know how to rule the devil. They had no name. We got one. They couldn't make no thoughts. They would. Jesus came and told them, you commit adultery in your heart when you look on a woman to lust after her. Jesus came to deal with the heart. Because you can look so good outwardly, but the Lord looks on the inside. What's some little secret thoughts you be embracing? And so look, now get your shopping clothes on. You ain't gonna shop, put your Bible under your seat. She said, that Messiah's coming. He gonna tell us everything. Look at verse 26. I that speak unto thee am he. I'm here. Now watch this. What y'all did? Y'all didn't get it. No, that wasn't it. I'm here who's fitting to explain everything about God to you. That's who's here.
All right.
That's who's here. I'm finna command you to love one another as I love you, being an example on the cross how to go live this. I am gonna be an example how you can take my name and make the devil stop. When you submit to God, you're submitting to Christ's words. When you cast down thoughts, they're exalting themselves against the knowledge of God. But you bring them into captivity to the obedience of Jesus' words. Jesus' authority. Jesus on the cross. Yes. Yes. Lord. Yes. Lord. Yes. No, you're just Jesus. You preach Jesus. What about God? You can't preach a better God than Christ. The Bible is the good news of Jesus Christ. And that is my Father who sent him. Now, what was that? What was that? So Jesus is here, y'all, to explain. Go back, go back, 1 Peter 5, 6, 7. Give me a few more minutes. And I'm just getting started. Now listen carefully now. Humble yourself. Under the mighty hand of God's love that was in Christ Jesus. And let me show you this love a little bit better picture. In John 15, verse 9. John 15, verse 9, 10, 11, 12, and 13. Jesus said, as the Father have loved me, so have I loved you. So the love we see in Jesus is really God. It's the Father. Jesus didn't originate nothing. God ordained his coming and what he was going to say and do. Jesus said, I didn't come to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. Now watch, watch. So Jesus said, and I want you to hear this in the spirit, not in your head, though your head is still here. As the Father loved me, this is so important to whether people are going to really walk in real victory or not. As the Father have loved me, so have I loved you. And then listen, that's how I want it. That's not it. This is it. Continue ye in my love. He ain't tell you continue how you feel about nothing. He ain't tell you continue what you think. He don't want to hear what you think about the president. He just wants you to love him and pray for him. You don't want to hear nothing you think. You don't want to hear what you feel. You don't want to hear what you don't like. You don't even want to hear what you disagree with. You done been a mess for years. He done gave you mercy. Lord, somebody had to have some real love to pray for you. Somebody did. Somebody suffered. Pray for all of us. Jesus said, listen to me now. Continue ye in my love. He is not up in heaven talking about you. You're not in his love when you're down here running off at the mouth. Every time you turn on the news and hear something about our president, say, I love him and Jesus love him. Yes. And let that cut you off. Yeah. And get on your knees and pray. We pray for Obama. Yeah. Dear God, we had to intercede. Yeah. We had to pray and receive if he was saved or not. I mean, a lot of them decisions, dear God. Yeah. I'm shunned that I was Sunday for him. And then you got a Sunday that I was on for Trump when you said 2 Corinthians. I mean, you got a Sunday that I don't know about Satan. Oh, and then by whoever get elected, you got a Sunday that I don't know about Satan. Listen to those words again. Continue ye. And how I loved you on the cross and took your sins away while you were guilty. And then he go verse 10 and say, if you keep my commandments. Nah, don't go back to love God with your heart, soul, mind, strength, love your neighbor. Say, that's not his commandments. That's what God gave to Moses. That's not Jesus' commandments. They were the spiritual Jews under the law who were spiritually dead. They could not bear no commandment to love like Jesus because they ain't had a new nature yet. So don't go there. Go to verse 12. This, Jesus said, this is real clear. This is my commandment. Listen, that you love one another as I have loved you. Where did he love you? On the cross. He didn't love us nowhere else. We ain't had no promises. We ain't had none. We was in Ephesians 2:12. At that time, we were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise. We had no hope. We were out without God's love. We were without God's promise. We couldn't expect nothing from God. But now, those who will fall are made nigh by the blood of Christ. That is the only reason we have anything with God is because of the blood of Jesus Christ. You can't earn this, but you can live it. Now watch. Watch. Verse 10, if you keep my commandments, these two of them. First one is believe, 1 John 3:23. John said, this is Jesus' commandment, that we believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. Your first commandment as a Christian is to believe on the character and the authority that you see in Jesus. You have to believe that so you can get an identity of who you are. And the authority you have and the love is shed in your heart. When you see Jesus, you got the same love and you got the same authority. Watch that. If you keep my commandments of believing how I loved you and then living that toward one another, Jesus said this, you will abide in my love. He ain't talking about no Ten Commandments, no loving God. Loving God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbors yourself never kept you in his love. It'll never keep you in his love because ain't no forgiveness in them. There's no redemption in God. God don't show you how to do that. He didn't tell you to do it. Jesus showed you how to do it and give you the grace to do it. Yeah. The scripture tells us we only love him because he first loved us. You can't fix this, add to it or take away. You got to receive from Christ and then go live who he made you and what he's done for you. 1 John 14 said, not that we love God, but he loved us. Gave himself us a perpetuation for our sins. So if God so loved us, we ought to also love one another. He's first. He's got to do it first, y'all. That's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now listen carefully now. I've been teaching this stuff for years. Jesus said, if you keep my commandments, you'll abide in my love. Now watch Jesus. Even as I kept my Father's commandments and abided in his love. The Ten Commandments wasn't God's love. You broke one of them, man, you was condemned. There wasn't no love in them commandments. You broke one, you broke them all. They had condemnation. If you broke them, the law was good within itself, but it's when man got a hold of it and broke them, it got screwed up. So what did Jesus keep that kept him in the Father's love? Verse 9, as the Father loved me, he lived Father's love to us. And when we live Jesus' love, we produce the same God that he produced. Not a little bit. When 8.5 years, y'all, I ain't had a depressed day. I just don't worry about nothing. I don't let problems come and rest and build no nest in my mind. I don't let them do it. Jesus taught me this in 1990. He talked to me for 15 years, just in a voice every day, so I could teach his people. And people say, I wish he'd talk to me like that. I said, all you gotta do is listen to my CDs. He'll talk to you every time. And they want to tell him how to do it. Listen, now, listen. He wanted to do, me and my wife, we just, you know, the first 2 years, man, I thought I married the devil. I mean, y'all kind of felt like that right at the beginning. Said, dear God, what in the world? I want that woman I married first. What happened to her? And Jesus said this to me. I was fasting, praying in the cabin. On third day, Jesus come talk to me. I mean, just in a dialogue. I talked to him, he talked to me. I'd ask him questions, he'd answer them. He'd tell me what he wanted me to do. I'd go back and do it. And the Lord told me, he said, listen, you can leave your wife. I still love her. I'm so afraid he wasn't going to love me no more. You could kill 10 men, get forgiven, get out of prison, everybody clap and love your church. You tell them I've been divorced, they want to stone you. And he wasn't telling me to divorce my wife so I could marry nobody else. He wasn't going to let me get married no more. He's going to let me separate. So don't be trying to grab that and use it wrongly. I sat there for a few seconds, a few minutes, and thought about it. I said, Lord, I don't want to do nothing to hurt you. Divorce hurts you. I don't want to do that. He just had enough confidence in me that I'd make the right decision. I said, Lord, I'm going to trust you. He said, all right, here's what you do. You read 1 Corinthians 14, 4 through 8 in the Amplified Bible. And you read 1 Peter chapter 3. Now you read 7 through 12. Go tell her to read 1 through 3. She didn't do it, but I did it every day for 8.5 years before I missed the day. He said, if you don't read these every day, you're going to get divorced. And so I got after it. Every day I read it. I mean, as soon as she do something ugly, I go read them and just get free. And then she do something else later on, I read them, get free. They kept me. I read 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8 in the Amplified Bible. For 6 months, I got convicted. It said, love takes no account of the evil. I said, oh, Lord, I got a long wrap it up. Everything she undid. And this, man, scroll, why the scroll? You done this, you did this, you did this. And she really done it. And so after 6 months, I never had that no more. Now, I don't remember nothing. She came back, she got delivered in 2001. She stayed in bondage 12 years, just rejected me all the time. And she came back after the Lord delivered her, and she came to her right mind, started walking along. She said, honey, you know all them years I was in bondage. She said, not one time was you mean to me. She said, you paid all the bills. You took care of everything. You let me keep my whole check, never bothered me about it. Now let me tell y'all about the real Jesus. When I went back to love her, reading them verses, it wasn't enough. She did something, man, I'm talking about this really hurt me. And the Lord said, Jesus said to me, well, forgive it and forget it. He always put that forget it on it. Because you ain't really forgave. And it can come back and move you. See, when you don't forgave it, forget it, oh, no, they ain't do that, see. So you don't accept it. And so here's what Jesus said to me, y'all. This is one of the most astounding words to my heart, beside that 1 John 1, 9. Right here. And then another time he told me he loved me. But this right here was the greatest, one of the greatest words I ever got from Jesus. And he was reminding me this on the way to church tonight. I want you to tell them what I told you. And here's what Jesus said to me. I said, Lord, she's going to keep hurting me. He said, I don't care what she do. It is not my concern. My only concern is you respond with me. Your response is me. My whole thinking changed. I started living this in my whole life. So I never stay on people about nothing. I know when stuff wrong, I reckon I try to help people come out. When it ain't none of my business, I'm telling y'all, I don't spend a lick of time on what's wrong with folks. And I'm going to live a long time. Unless Jesus tarries. Am I not saying like that? Come on now. Yeah. Holy Ghost. Yeah. Oh yeah, I'll be tearing up people for doctrines. But I don't tear them up. I tell what's wrong. I keep it. I keep it off people. And he that a love life. I've been blessed and fortunate, you know. Not been being cut on and stuff. He that a love life. I'm not condemning you, you know. If you had to go get cut, you had to go get cut. But just know your tongue ain't been right. He that a love life and see good days, let refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no God. Now Satan will come try to attack us. That doesn't mean that you off because you got attacked. Let's just see you come out of it. See, you go around looking every time you see somebody going to do something, you think that you just knocking them out. That's not always true. Sometimes you got to fight good fight faith. That's amen anyway.
Amen.
You got to make that monkey stop.
Hallelujah.
Now watch it. Watch now. Jesus kept two commandments. And he fulfilled the law, y'all. How the Father loved him. He loved us. That's all he kept. And you'll never break the Ten Commandments when you keep loving like Jesus. You can't go to bed with another man's wife. You can't do it and live in his love. You can't steal nobody. You can't covet. You can't bear false witness. You can't lie. You can't cheat. And you can't have no other God because you know who brought that love in you.
Amen.
You can't do it. They ain't bringing the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So Jesus' commandment is not just the law. It's fulfilling the law without you and I's strength. When you yield to the Holy Spirit who shed that blood in you, you will not break God's laws.
Amen.
Righteous people don't need laws. When he makes you righteous, you don't need the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments are for the lawless. Because something inside of you gonna be bugging you. Straighten up. And if it ain't down there bugging you, you don't have him yet. It's simple. I was in Tulsa preaching years ago, back in 91. I came down here and I got in another church and it wasn't here and they don't let me come on, so I did my best shot at them. They wasn't like Pastor Hill. And the Lord that I was up there, I just got through preaching all I knew. And I was preaching what Jesus taught me. And the Lord said, there's a lady back there. She's been ill and in unforgiveness for 2 years. She said her boyfriend took all her money out of bank account and left her. And so I called her. I said what the Lord told me. She come out. I hate him. I said, come on, girl. You finna get saved. And I begin to quote the scripture, you know ain't no murder got eternal life. And Jesus said down in my spirit, he said, no, that's my daughter. I said, no, ain't no way. Lord, the Bible say she's a murderer. She hates. He said, no, that's my daughter. So he said, ask her again. I said, ma'am, how you feel about that? I hate him. He took all my money 2 years ago. I hate him. And then Jesus brought me revelation. He said, put down to her belly. And Tamar said, anything down there scratching? She said, there's something down there telling me not to believe like that. He was down there, but her head was in the way. All you gotta do is ask people when they act ugly, check down there. They said, check where? Well, he down there. If he's down there, he's a scratching. If you up here trying to act ugly. I learned that day. And then I was preaching in the projects. Man, I went on these wine holes. My hood dude got me all smelling like whiskey. I hugged him, told him I loved him. I started quoting scripture, and all of a sudden he butted in, quoted more than me. I said, that's the devil. I said, that's the devil. Jesus said, no, that's my son. I said, Lord, how the world a man a drunk is your son? And Jesus said to me, he said, over a year ago, his son died of cancer. The devil told him I'd done it. And he's been mad at me. He said, but I see how ignorant he is. He says, you tell him I love him because in a few years I'm going to rescue him out of this. But the man is my son. You need to read the scriptures. Jesus said, I know them that are mad. Not you know them that are his. He said, he know them that are his. Woo! Everybody messed up ain't out of his family. He sees more than we see. He killed all my theology, all my doctrines. He done slapped all of them back to hell. I just love and let him tell me if they ain't right or not. If he don't tell me, I just keep loving. Man, my life's so simple and easy, it's a shame. Never been late on bills, never paid any on credit card. Never been behind on night, never been paid a lot of things on last day. I do what he's saying today. Makes my believing work. So Jesus said, look, Jesus said, if you keep my commandments, you'll abide in my love. John 15, verse 10, even as I kept my Father's man abide in his love. Then Jesus said, these things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you. What? His joy? What's his joy? How the Father loved him. And then that his joy might fill my joy and my joy be full with how he loved me and I go get that love to you. You are the happiest Christians in the world when you just love people. They are the most kindest and happiest people. And when you find them grumpy ones and always been arguing and fussing, they sound mean and looking, you can't even tell they no Christian. Oh, that grumpy and grumpy. Stop it. Okay, here we go. In verse 12, this is my commandment. That you love one another as I loved you on the cross. Listen, you can't even live this commandment. You can't live it. Why? You can't live it. Nobody can read this and live this. Why? Because the commandment only tells you what to do. It doesn't tell you how. You have to go to the cross to see how you got love before you can come back and obey this. You should be looking at that cross every day, all day, how he loved you. Day and night, you should meditate on it. You should keep this in your mind, how he loved you. It's going to make your faith work. It's going to keep you out of unforgiveness. It's going to keep the devil at bay. You're going to keep living in authority. You're going to be able to walk in victory. You're going to get blessed. You're going to prosper because you're going to be able to pray and get answers. And John said, these things, Jesus said, these things I've spoken to you, that my joy right remain in you and your joy might be full. Now this is my commandment, that you love one another as I love you. By this, listen, Jesus said, greater love have no man than this. He wanted you to know you ain't never going nowhere ever in eternity and find no greater love than what he did on the cross. It don't exist. Now, you are my friends. If you do whatever I command, he's pointing you back to what he just got to telling you, that this is how you his friend, you live his love toward others. Yeah. I've been his friend for 28 and a half years. Our dog, did I tell you about our dog? Did I tell you last time I was here about our dog? I did. We got a little English dog. Somebody paid $4,500 for that dog. They couldn't take care of it. We didn't mind. That'd been a dream for my wife all her life, is to have a dog like that. There was one bill that I'd have gave $100 for him or something, not $4,500. And he was running through the house, broke his foot. And the Anita and Rob laid hands on, prayed for him and believed God. And so I came home and they took him to the doctor, put a cast and said it broke. I said, nah, I'm gonna believe. This was Friday. We getting ready to go out of town Sunday. I said, I'm gonna believe by next Friday he'll be healed. Next Friday. And so, you know, they believed he was healed. I talked to them out. But see, then we I took my family down there, take a few days off, and we pray and get with the Lord. And I told him, you know, I told my son, I said, son, I'm going to get Rico's healing this week down here. I said, I'm going to get it. It's a little different, y'all. And so, you know, I rested Monday night. And then I got Tuesday night, I got over in the spirit, and then I done rested good in my body, and I started praying in tongues just for hours. That's what I rest for, praying in tongues a lot. And I told the Lord, I got over in the spirit, and I began to tell the Lord Jesus how wonderful it was, how thankful I was for that love on the cross. And then I just eased off in the spirit and said, Lord Jesus, will you heal my dog by Friday? And then in my spirit, he didn't say nothing. In my spirit, he said, I just sensed this. Quote Mark 11:23. So I quoted Mark 11:23. So then Monday night, he done tore his cast off. So we took him back and got they took him back the next day. People was keeping him, and he got another cast on. Then we get home Thursday. And then we go to church. He got mad because we're in church. He just ate the whole thing. Gretchen put a great big cast on. He wasn't able to get that thing off. He chewed that thing in 100 pieces. Then it's all chipped, the bone broke, and everything. So now we call. They said, we'll bring him in tomorrow. We'll put another cast on. But it's Friday. When she examined, she said, well, he doesn't need a cast. I don't understand this. We said, ma'am, he's healed. And Friday he was healed. Ain't never had a cast on, just running, flying, jumping. No. Did you get it? I got my dog healed from my relationship that he loves me. And I always do what he say. And only you can get this personally. You can't teach this. People have to catch it. When you please him, he gonna please you. I'm just telling you, he'll do the smallest little things for you, the little things you look like he won't do, he'll do them just for you. Yeah, he will. It pays to obey the Lord. It pays to serve Christ. It pays to do what Jesus, it pays to be a witness. It pays to share Jesus with people and do what he said. Have his interest more than yours. I go back, 1 Peter 5. Let me get ready to close.
Yes.
Let me get ready to close. I'm going to pick it up tomorrow. I got some more. I ain't even getting it nowhere near finished. Lord, this messed up my whole message I had for the night. Jesus just messed it all up. Just mess it up and see what he wanted to say. Ain't that wonderful? Humble yourself, therefore, in the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time. You humble yourself under love. On the cross. When you humble yourself under his love, God, who is love, and God sent Jesus, listen, he exalts you in due time, no matter what your case is. Watch here, look for verse 8 or verse 7. Here's your humble, casting all your care on him, never having nothing in your life you got to work out and fix. Nothing. Tornado came, so? Not gonna mess up my house. Just go outside and tell that thing you ain't gonna tap my house. And if you like me and don't want to have to go and help nobody know how, don't let it come in your neighborhood. They just protected it, man. I know y'all, you know, you think they don't come to Nashville. They done been down there. I taught my son, I rebuke them. They had one coming to a school. The whole school was panicking. It was an F3, and it's coming. It's headed straight for them. The police, the fire department, everybody will call them and tell them, look out, it's too late. We can't get them out. Y'all take cover. And so they was panicking, hollering, screaming. My son was standing up in the class doing like this. And then she said, what do you want, Robert Scales? He said, if you let me rebuke it, said it won't come here. He went, and the teacher said, well, go ahead. And he said, my daddy taught me in the name of Jesus, I rebuke that tornado. You will not come here and tear up this school. And listen, and the tornado just went another direction and didn't come now they dwelling. You up here hiding. Ain't no way where I'm going under there. It's dirty under there. That go in the lowest place in your house. It's dirty under there. I'm not going under there. In that crawl space. Sit in my chair. If God be for me, you live in this love every day. Witnessing and wanting people not to go to hell. Making sure you keep it a compassion to share Jesus every chance you get. I ain't lost that Pastor Hill in 28 and a half years. I still win people to Jesus every week. I'm in the prison 3 or 4 times a week. I got young men serving the Lord, man. It's just glorious to watch. They on fire for God. Let me get real close. Casting all of them. Now, what's your purpose for that? He cares for you. It's got to be the key. You got to see how much he loves you. He cares for you. Listen. He cares for you. He cares for you. On the cross. Man, he bent all your knees. He gave you everything pertaining unto life and godliness. He done already blessed you. And I don't know why people still try to get blessed. He's already blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ. Just obey Jesus every day. Be serving your church. Be faithful to your church, your pastor. Listen, do what Jesus say at work every day. Invite people to church. Read your Bible every day and pray. You'll stay blessed. Lord Jesus, nobody demand you to get no money you want to give. Tell you he'll have it all if he want it. All right, here we go. Casting all your cares on you. You're not humble when you have cares. Concerns, anxiety, stress, worry. You're not humble under his love on the cross. He wants all of them. He don't want you taking 1 minute trying to figure out how you're going to make it in nothing. Then we said, be sober, be vigilant, be alert, be vigilant, be in right thinking about Jesus and the cross. For your adversary, the devil, walking about how, as a roaring lion, what's he walking about doing? Seeking. Who cares? Who's mad? Who's offended? Who's bothered? I just don't know why all this happened to me. You got devils. I'm telling you, anybody's picking on me, you have devils. Listen, all of Israel, I was going to go that night, but I didn't make it. 1 Samuel, listen, all of Israel was scared, Saul and all of them, when the giant came out and told them, bring me one man. They was terrified. They were dismayed. He came back out and said it again, and he said it around the wrong person. It was a little young boy that named David. And what was the difference between David and all them? The army. David knew the Lord cared for him. He had delivered him from the bear and the lion. And God said, that same God, come on now, that same God who cared for me will deliver you into my hand. And you're supposed to look back at the cross, look at some of them tests and trials you done been through, and tell the devil, the same Jesus who brought me out before, he'll do it again. And you can face any Goliath. You can face any situation, because the Lord do never will leave you on the same. Never. 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 Say it with me. And so the devil cannot devour everybody. He has to wait till you bothered by something. And something's coming. I done had about 3,000 chances this year to get bothered. You understand? They take advantage of that. They probably wasn't waiting out of the church, but I ain't finna let it bother me. Hello, there's another one. Oh, Jesus, there's another one. Can I tell y'all what Jesus taught me back in 1988? You sure you want to know?
Yeah.
You sure not?
Yeah.
I got so mad. Girl, I had a baby back in college. Told me she won't never let my daughter come up here no more. Now she came up here, spent all summer with it. I'm on crack and I mean on drugs and smoking cocaine, heroin, drinking. I'm lying right in front of her, smoking weed, rolling my joint, watching Boston and LA. And then when I get saved, she don't want to be no more. I said, I won't do none of that no more. I ain't never going back down. I ain't never done no rotten meal, nothing. And this little boy said, oh yeah, you're gonna love her. I said, well, I guess I am, because you said it. And Jesus asked me a question, listen to this. He said, can you add any cubic or statue to this? I thought about it. I said, hold on, Lord, hold on. Let me think about that. I thought about it. I said, Lord, I can't fix this. He said, I can't, trust me. I got revelation from that moment on, from 1988, not to never work out nothing. That I can, all I got to do is give me about 3 to 5 seconds. I can tell you if I can work it out or not. That's all I need is 3 to 5 seconds. And I said, oh no, case for Jesus. Attorney, lawyer, got another case for you. Hey, Jesus, here's another one. Here's another one. Just give me 3 to 5 seconds. And let me just think, can I add any cubic or statue to it? And I don't take thought about tomorrow. I don't take thought about what happened around the world. I don't take thought about what, I'm telling you, it's just so bad. I don't ever talk like that. I ain't taking no thought about nothing. I'm doing what Jesus tell me to do. I'm building this kingdom up. I ain't got time to think about what's going on in the world. You ought to hear people just talk, 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 talk. They don't ever talk about Jesus. They talk, 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 talk. They don't ever talk about Jesus. So we talking, yapping, yippee, yapping. Somebody need to slap your lips. Tell you to put some Jesus in your mind. I'm tired of hearing you talk about everything. Talk about your child. Talk about how people are. Talk about what you don't like. Talk about that. Talk about that. Stop in the name of love. Oh, you break my heart. And devil, never sit there and walk by the wrong man seeking. He can't come to me. He can't come and divide me. He flat can't do it, y'all. If he had, he done it in 28 years. He can't do it. He can't begin to divide me. Why? Because I'm not going to believe in fear. I'm going to believe the Lord cares for me. Yeah. And that makes my faith work. It makes me trust him. And believe what he say and not what that say. Yeah. Whom resists steadfast in the faith? Your faith is Jesus on the cross. Yeah. How he loved you and gave himself for you. Yeah. So he gave himself to deliver you from this present evil world.
Yeah.
Now I got to close one more verse and I'm going to pick this back up tomorrow. Yeah. In Mark 4, verse 19. Well, let me read 18. And then we'll pick it back up tomorrow. Come on now, you're going to go home. Listen, when I preach, your kids ain't going to be tired. My son was up in revivals and everything. He never went to school tired. We laid hands on him and said, you'll have more strength tomorrow than you had if you slept all night. The Holy Ghost is up on you. You ain't supposed to believe they're going to be tired. And God is saying something. Verse 18, I didn't do that, didn't I? I won't charge y'all for that. These are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word. So the wayside heard the word. Devil came, stole it. The stony heart heard the word. Then when affliction, persecution rose, they got offended. And then those who have thorn hearts, they heard the word. Watch. And the cares of this world. I'm going to explain to y'all what that means tomorrow. And the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things. In the end, choke the word. And what happens? Listen, saints, what you got to know tonight, Satan heard Jesus teach this. He knows what will get his word not to work in our lives. He knows. He wants you concerned about finances. He wants you concerned about your children. He wants you concerned about your marriage. He wants you concerned about your job, security. He just wants you bothered. He don't care what it is. He gives him a door to devour you. Then you got to close all up. No, I ain't working that out. No, that wouldn't either. Hallelujah. A lot of Christians choke the word. And guess what it don't produce? It doesn't produce Jesus. His love. His victory. It's not being perfect. I don't repeat it more than all y'all. But one thing, I've lived perfect for 28 and a half years. Perfect. I always do what he tell me. I never disobey what he tell me. He said, stop this, I stop that. Go here, I go there. Do this, I do that. I never disobey him. I'm still doing and living what he taught me back in 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 2000, 2001, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, and this year too. Amen. I don't forget what he told me to do. Why? It ain't gonna work if you forget it. And don't do it. You'll produce something else. So you know that's what intrigued me so much when I first got saved. I got that 30-day chip. And I got up and told him anything. I said, by the grace of God, y'all. I said, Jesus Christ set me free. By the grace of God, I'm here clean and sober. I never will use another day of my life. The Lord Jesus Christ set me free. Oh, they just growl, get mad, because they say y'all ain't going to be an addict. They just hate me saying that. I get up saying it every time. I say it thousands of times. And by the grace of God, Jesus set me free. I never will use no more.
Yes.
Listen, and he told me, he said, I want you, he told me February 7th, 1989, quit your job, follow me. I quit that day, I ain't gonna ask nobody. He done got me new cars with chapter 13. He made banks give me $20-something loans. I didn't have no 1040, no 1099, no 10 nothing. And he just tell the bank president, never met him before. Tell him that I told you to come and that he was going to make sure all my car notes got paid. And the Lord never, we never missed one. We're on 11th or 12th Lexus. After years, so I gave me another one because he lets me, you know, it's just like a lease, but I put so many miles on. And so I didn't go get another one. I mean, you're going to pay the same amount. Why not have another one after a year or so? Keep them cars forever. But it's all right if you do. What was I telling y'all right after? I had one more thing. What was that? Then what was I telling him? Well. I said, thank you, brother. And you helped me out. Y'all stand to your feet. That brother helped me out. Man, where you hurting at? Lower back. Well, man, praise God. No, he already done it. Ooh. Thank you, Lord. hands, give Jesus all the glory. It's enough, the Lord said, for you to just do what I told you. Don't let nothing else come and try to get you off on doing something else. It's enough that you just do, yeah, it's enough that you just do what he's told you. You don't have to care what man think. It's enough for you to just do what the master told you to do. Keep your whole heart in what the Lord told you to do. And don't you go to the left or right. Lift your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Let's stand up for a minute. Come on, get back up again. Get back up. Sit back down and say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Come on, y'all, let's just worship our King. Get back up, sir. Get back up again. Used to bench that time. What happened?
You're God. You're God.
Watch this. Watch this. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. Not a love for God. Say that. Not a love for God. But a God love me. Don't hurt her. Come on, y'all lift your hands. Anybody else hurting, sick, with anything, that thing got to go tonight in Jesus' name. Man, I prayed for you last time I was here. How you doing? Girl, you ain't even got all that. You shata la 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 baka. Shukoho. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Woo! Look at her, man. She was bound all up last time I was here, and she over there did it happy and free as can be. That's our Jesus. That's our Jesus. Woo! Y'all, I can't wait till tomorrow. Man, I didn't even get in this day. But I will tomorrow. Y'all lift your hands again. With the fruit of your lips, giving thanks to his name. In Jesus' name. Y'all know I fly. I don't drive no more now. I only drive when I drive. They drive me. God gave me help. But they drive my car down here. I fly. They pick me up at the airport. And we do drive from Kansas down here. But this Thursday morning, I'm back on that plane, man. And then my sons, they young, man. Shoot. When I was their age, man, I drove over a million miles on that car. Driving, man, for Jesus. It's their turn now. Shit, I done paid my dues. Hey, man, God gonna bless me because I'm gonna do right. Hey, man, y'all, let me tell y'all something, saying this. Hope y'all get the CD of the night. Yes, yes. You need to hear this again. Yeah. Y'all need to hear this again. God is not out to get, he's out. He done loved us in Jesus. Yeah, you can live crazy and you're gonna reap death. The way to see is death. You're gonna get judged. They talk about ain't no more judgment. Man, them boys is crazy saying that stuff. You can still get judged, but the blood of Jesus will unjudge you. You walk contrary to the word, you're going to reap contrary to the word. You walk contrary to obey Jesus, you'll reap obeying Jesus. Saints, according to your faith, be it done unto you. I'm balanced. I done got some whooping from the Lord. I ain't had that in years. I don't like them. I don't like them whoopings, man. I don't have. Man, I got so sick. I quoted scriptures for 3 hours, nothing happened. I said, all right, Lord, well, I'm dead wrong. when you go to work for 3 hours and the devil don't have to let you go, you better bow down until you're called another station. And Jesus said, you remember first of the year I told you to take 2 days off and rest? I said, oh, well, yeah, I do remember you. I said, Lord, I'm so sorry. You forgive me. Got up the next morning, felt 100% better. Went out, started doing stuff. Got sick as a dog again. Came back, crawled in my house. Crawled in. We lived in an apartment then. Crawled in there. I thought it was heaven on earth. We had 2 bathrooms. I thought we were just doing one. We stayed in an apartment 11 and a half years. And then he blessed my first house. In 2000, then we moved in another house. We got a real night out now. That's, I mean, it's, and we didn't pay you again. Praise God. We don't have no car, no house notes. Me and my wife took all our retirement, all our money, and we bought that house. God told us how to do it, so we would never have no house notes. And so now he's got to build a retirement back up. Who cares? I don't ever plan on doing it no way. When I'm through ministry, I'm gone. I ain't sitting around no wheelchair, man, looking crazy every day, going home. Yeah, I told my son, you'll never take care of that. I'll be walking just as good when I'm 100 years old as I am today. Because I know what this, I have to ask the Holy Spirit, help me keep this thing from evil. Keep this right here off. Keep that thing off evil. And you'll see good days. Hallelujah. And live consecrated. And live holy. And they're sanctified like y'all pastor been teaching y'all. It's amen anyway.
Amen.
What was the story I was telling you, David? Did you remember? I was sick as a dog. I crawled back in the house. Got into bed. I told Jesus, I said, the Lord Jesus, I'll be honest with you. Now, if you used to come down here in my room and tell me I sinned this morning, I'd have to call you a liar. I lived carefully. I watched everything. And I'd have to call you a liar. And Jesus is real loving and kind. You know, because we real stupid when it comes to him. He said, yeah, you told me last night you were sorry, but you still ain't obeyed me. I said, ooh. Y'all think that sorry means something? Sorry to God never means nothing. We need to obey. To obey was you were sorry. So I told the Lord, Mr. Dunn, I said, the Lord, now you always ask me to keep your word. I said, this time as you keep mine. I give you my word for 48 hours. I'll never move. I'll cut the ring off. I won't answer the phone. I won't talk to nobody. And I'll rest for 2 days, exactly like you told me. She's trying to preserve my life, Pastor Hill. You got to rest sometime. You can't do everything. Listen, it's like a wind blew and all the symptoms disappeared.
Yeah.
I hugged them sheets and pillow for 2 days. I didn't budge. I learned from that whooping, do what he say. Y'all ready to stand to your feet? Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, I now just asking you a special blessing upon Northside Christian Center. The saints, Pastor Hill and Mary, all the ministers here, and your people, all of them. I just pray a special blessing from you, Lord, because they loved your servant and helped me to get this out to others. And Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord Jesus, for receiving this offering. Lord, I pray it's sending an aroma to heaven that you have people here that really love you.
Yes.
They love your word and they love your servant. And we thank you, Father, for it. In Jesus' name, amen. I love y'all.
All right, we're ready to go. But we just want to say that Brother Scales preached the word of God tonight. Oh, it warmed my heart. Amen. Amen. We just want you to bring your loved ones, bring your friends, bring your family members. Bring them here tomorrow night. We just believe that God has great things, amen, that's going to be released into this body on tomorrow night. So we just want you to make sure you be back at 7 o'clock. How many were blessed tonight? How many were blessed tonight? Tomorrow night is going to be a miracle night, just like tonight. It's going to be miracles. So we want to invite you back. The Lord watch between me and thee. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest upon us and guide and lead us and bring us back at the appointed time in Jesus' name. Amen.